In this unit, we'll learn about HTTP protocol, the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and its use on the web. First of all, we'll learn what a web page is. A web page is an internet page, which consists of text and zero or more objects. The object can be a file, a picture, a sound, video, and even a program loaded inside the page. The web page is written in a language called HTML. And inside the code itself, there are references to external objects. It's possible to reach the objects online in a number of ways, but the most common is via a URL, Uniform Resource Locator. We will more conveniently and understandably call the URL the website address or object address. The address consists of its head, which is the host name, that is, the name of the server the object is located in, and the second part is the path inside the server to reach that object. A server can contain a lot of objects, so it is important to not just reach it, but to also find the object inside. In the previous units, we learned about IP addresses, so it's important to understand the URL is translated to an IP address by an additional service called DNS, which we'll learn about later. The reason that the URL is verbal, even though computers work with IP addresses, is that, as users, it's more convenient to work with and remember words than numbers. Another reason is that the IP address can change even when the URL remains the same. The Hypertext Transfer Protocol, HTTP, is a protocol for transmitting web pages and objects online between a website located on a server and a point running an app for a host. This protocol continues to the application layer because it offers a website surfing service to the user. The communication model in HTTP protocols is always the server-client model and is based on request and response. The customer requests an object from the server, and the server returns the desired object. The client usually runs a web browser, but not necessarily. The browser has two main roles: to request and receive objects from the server, and to visually present them to the user. The server waits for a client request for the objects it stores and provides them. The client and the server communicate using HTTP protocol on the application layer, which is riding on TCP protocol in the transportation layer. As I mentioned, HTTP uses TCP, because what is required is reliable traffic for which a small delay can be tolerated. The server opens a socket and listens to port 80 for the client's connection requests. The client opens a socket on its end and uses some port that will report to the server in the future. The entire regular process for establishing a session vis-a-vis a server consists of establishing a connection with the server, which is listening to port 80. The server accepts and approves the connection, and later the client and server exchange request and response type messages. Finally, the connection between the points is closed. The server must continue remaining active in order to take care of other clients which are connected to it, or will be connected later. It's important to emphasize that HTTP is, at its base, a protocol lacking a state, or a stateless protocol. A stateless protocol is one that does not save information about the requests of currently connected clients, or those who were connected in the past. Protocols saving a request history are very complicated because that entails managing large databases, the ability to identify clients at different times and connections from different hosts, and coping with a very large number of actions in parallel. In this unit, we learned about HTTP and how it can use TCP in the transportation layer. We also learned what model this protocol uses, the client-server model, which is based on the method of alternating request-response between points.